probeert op te nemen. Fernando is hier niet, of wel? Okay. Zal ik dan, then I'll just start in English, because otherwise I'll have to switch halfway through. So, welcome. I'm Michel Jordan. Tina just introduced me, so I can smoothly over that. As you all know, sitting here, life can be very stressful. Work is often a source of stress for a lot of people. Some people, for some reason that's still beyond me, decide to have children, which only adds to the stress and adds to the sleep deprivation. And for this reason, a lot of people relax, a lot of people recreate. And recreate has a lot of benefits for mental and even physical health. So that's a good thing. We like people recreate. Recreation, for example, sports, however, also come with some risks. So if you take snowboarding, around 4 people in the Netherlands at least die of snowboarding a year. In Belgium, it's probably a bit less because you have less people, but it's probably also not. Some people like to swim, maybe not necessarily in this setting, but in a way. However, swimming also kills about 21 people per year. I don't have any slides about the coronavirus, in case anybody was wondering. Cycling kills about 12 people a year. In other words, recreation is really important and on average has a lot of benefits, so definitely recreate in however, whichever manner you choose, but it also comes with some risks. And the same goes for nightlife. So nightlife comes with some unique risks. We just don't know exactly how many are killed per year because we don't have organizations that keep track of this. We do know, however, that one of the main risks of nightlife settings relate to alcohol. And this is a Belgian poster wondering whether alcohol is really that bad for you. I didn't actually do any studies about this myself, but I happen to know that the answer, unfortunately, is yes, which is why the WHO adjusted the recommended alcohol intake to 0. Doesn't mean that you shouldn't ever drink any alcohol, because it can still have a lot of benefits. Plus, people always make choices. People are entitled to take risks if they feel it brings them something. That's why people go swimming, even though you can die if you swim. That's why people sometimes travel by car, even though participating in traffic can kill you. So people all the time balance lots of risks, balance their goals and what it brings them, etc. So nightlife also comes with some specific risks. And there's not only alcohol, but in nightlife people also use other drugs, such as ecstasy, MDMA, cocaine, GHB, ketamine, WCB, nitrous oxide, which is called laughing gas in Dutch, well, not in Dutch, but literally translated from Dutch. But there are also other risks associated to nightlife. For example, this is a big festival, and this is a speaker at this festival. Not a person, but like the device generating the sound. This is a person standing close to the speaker. The speaker is about 4 times as large as this person. There's a quite high likelihood that if this person doesn't actually use hearing protection, his hearing will become damaged. And then you might get something like, you might become completely deaf, of course, in the worst case. Although you could argue what the worst alternative is. You can also develop tinnitus. Not exactly sure how to pronounce it in English, but basically it's a permanent ringing in your ears for the rest of your life, which drives people crazy, apparently. So it's something you'd want to avoid, but it's definitely a risk of participating in nightlife settings. Nightlife is extremely diverse. You have festivals like this. You have regular nightlife settings with bars. You have daytime festivals, you have metal festivals, you have basically lots of different variations that all together form nightlife. And most people have some experience with some aspects of this nightlife. In Dutch, the term is kind of horeca. Lots of people go to a bar to get a coffee or to go for lunch somewhere, and they might have a glass of wine or they might play a band. So lots of these risks actually apply to a lot of people. Because the setting is so diverse and because you have so many actors, it's actually important to collaborate with all these actors. And that's one of the things, one of the projects that was started in the Netherlands a few years ago. And that's called the so-called Celebrate Safe project. The idea is that a number of different actors, like organizers of parties, prevention organizations, security organizations, so the people who actually hire the security people that are at parties or events, first aid services in nightlife settings. So if you have a big party like I Love Techno, you need to have a dedicated first aid post there. All these people got together and decided they wanted to create an initiative to improve the health of people participating. It started with ID&T in the US. ID&T is a huge Dutch party organizer. Maybe people might know Thunderdome, which was a big series of parties from the 90s, back when hardcore was still the thing. And everybody looked like me at those parties. So ID&T is old and they have a lot of experience. And these parties, the early dance scene, was mostly underground. So most of these parties were just organized illegally by people who had a sound system and they wanted to have nice music. And there was no other way to go to parties with nice music, so they did it themselves. This organization grew into a huge professional organization. And at some point, they were bought or merged into or whatever, a huge American company called SFX, Sound Effects. And there they started organizing parties in the US. And they brought people from the Netherlands, of course, because they have a lot of experience. And they found, to their horror, that there was no prevention activity there, almost no. Because the US, much more than the Netherlands, has an abstinence-based prevention policy, if you can call it like that. So for a long time in the US, people weren't actually allowed to give sexual education at schools, because the message was, the best sexual education is to not have, I can't even say it seriously, not have sex before you marry. That's how you prevent HIV, and that's how you prevent teenage pregnancies. Just not have sex until you're married. So therefore, you don't have to explain to people how condoms work. Because if you explain to them how condoms work, they might have sex before they marry. So that's an abstinence-based approach. In the Netherlands, we're like, yeah, right. So we better explain to children how condoms work, because they will probably have sex before they marry. The same thing applies to drugs. So a country can have an abstinence-based drug prevention approach, where they say, we're not going to tell people how to use drugs in the least harmful way. Or they can do what the Netherlands does, and they say people are going to use drugs anyway, and so we might as well tell them how we can keep the damage to a minimum. Because there was nothing in the US, Laura Eva Jacobsen, this person, came up with the idea of Celebrate Safe, which consisted basically of 10 so-called pillars, 10 main messages that are important to take into account. And each had a bit of more explanation, and they used this as a campaign at the parties. Then she came back to the Netherlands, and she got in touch with Judith Nooyen, who works at Jelinek Prevention, which is a large Dutch drug prevention organization. And they decided to write a proposal to get funding to get this larger project, Celebrate Safe, started in the Netherlands. And they succeeded. They got in touch with organizers from parties, like Rubinia, who is an organizer, and some of these people. And they created this idea. And the crucial, well, success factor in this project is that you have these organizers and you have people from government. Well, they mostly paid and weren't involved much for the rest, but money is important, so it's also very important. You have people from prevention, you have people from first aid. There was one other person who's not on this picture. And me, you have also have expertise in behavior change. And if you combine all these, it actually becomes possible to create interventions that target not only the individual partygoers, but also things in their environment, for which obviously you'll need the organizers' help, or the security organizations, or the first aid organizations, etc. Is what became first aid. So as you see, there were loads of organizations and loads of people involved, which also makes this seem the appropriate time to thank all these people and organizations, because everything I'll present now, the party panel results, wouldn't actually have been possible if everybody here wouldn't have collaborated in some way. These people, in particular, were very involved in either the party panel questionnaires or in specific waves. And of course, the participants mostly made all this possible, because without participants, you have no data. Well, we had one Dutch researcher who managed to create data without participants, but that didn't end well. I'll now show one of the outcomes of the project, and then I'll give a bit more details about actually the content and how we got here and why we actually decided to make movies in the end. This is a movie that was targeted, that's important to know, to prevention workers, because the goal of this party panel study was actually to cater to prevention workers, and I'll explain why and how after this little movie.
In 2015, we conducted a survey among 868 participants who go out and use ecstasy from time to time. We asked them about different beliefs related to three specific behaviors: buying highly dosed ecstasy pills, using a high dose of MDMA, and having ecstasy pills tested. In this video, we highlight using a high dose of MDMA. This part of show that the intention of using a high dose of MDMA is related to the belief that this will affect the positive effects like intoxication, experiencing a longer and more intense high, and connecting more easily with others. That you can say no when someone offers you MDMA while already intoxicated. That this affects your hangover the following days, and that you'll be sorry the next day. It's remarkable that participants understand that higher doses of MDMA involve greater health risks, but that this understanding doesn't really affect their behaviour. During an intervention, you can explain that a higher dose of MDMA increases the chances of unwanted effects. Higher doses increase social isolation, make it feel like time passes more quickly, and can cause hallucinations. Also, the effects people want, such as feeling euphoric, connecting with others, and socialising more easily, decrease. Click here for more info about Party Panel, or visit the website.
Okay, so this is what we created in the end. Now I'll get to how we got here before the YouTube starts playing the next move. I'll first explain a little bit about behavior change, because the goal here is to make nightlife more healthy, to prevent incidents and long-term damage from various causes. And we do this through changing people's behavior. So I'll first explain a bit about how we think about behavior if we do behavior change science. Then I'll explain a little bit about how we designed the Party Panel project, and I'll show some results from the five waves we have. And finally, last year we did an evaluation of this Celebrate Safe approach, where Party Panel results were also used. And mostly because the results were very positive, obviously, I also want to show those. And then there's time for questions. So the goal is, if you are a behavior change professional or researcher or a prevention worker, the goal is basically to make people happier or healthier. And for this goal, we developed lots of interventions. These are examples of some Dutch interventions. But those interventions can't work directly on people's health or quality of life. They always have to work through those people. Basically, people's behavior determines their health or their quality of life. So that means you have to change their behavior. And behavior normally is defined as muscle activity. Basically, your muscles allow you to talk, your muscles allow you to move, your muscles allow you to lift a bollock into your mouth and drink, etc. Therefore, if you want to make people happier and healthier, you need to control their muscles. The muscles need people controlled by their central nervous system. So if you want to control people's behavior, you need to control their central nervous system, which is controlled ultimately from their brain. So therefore, if you want to change anything about how people feel or how healthy people are, you'll have to figure out. The brain has the motor cortex, which is located roughly like here, maybe a bit more to the side, but you get the drift. And the motor cortex is called the motor cortex because it's responsible for motor activity, so it controls all your muscles. So that means that you need to control the motor cortex, so you need to figure out what you need to do in the brain to make sure that the motor cortex sends the right signals at the right moment, so that people stop drinking, or don't use ecstasy, or use a condom, or go running, or whatever else you want them to do. Inside our brain are cells that are not very originally called brain cells, or neurons. If you study psychology, you'll probably have seen pictures of neurons in textbooks, and they're usually depicted something like this, although less dynamic usually. So basically you have the cell body, and then you have like a tentacle-like thingy that goes to one or more other neurons. And then a neuron can be activated, and then it spreads a signal to other neurons. Actually, it turns out that this is a gross oversimplification, as I found out only a few years ago to my dismay. I'll get back to that later. We have a lot of these neurons. We have about 90 billion, of 90 miljard. That's quite a big number, lots of zeros. So to give you some frame of reference, we have about 200 billion stars in our galaxy, and there are about 7 billion people on the planet. And I mean, I don't know about you, I probably don't even know half of them. So imagine how many there are. These 90 billion neurons are connected to, on average, 7,000 other neurons. Not like one or two, as they draw them in the pictures in the textbooks, like 7,000. So that means there are a lot of connections. This, those 90 billion neurons connected to, on average, 7,000 of those other 90 billion neurons, is pretty much what you are. So that means that all we need to do, if we want to change people's behavior, is figure out which of those 90 billion neurons connected to 90 billion neurons with 7,000 connections we need to change. That's a bit hard because they're really small, so it takes ages before you find the right one if you have like a pincet. Tweezers, yes, thank you. But luckily, there are actually other approaches we can use, but we'll have to zoom out a little bit from this. Before we do that, we have to acknowledge that actually, if you want to change people's behavior, you can't just change that individual. Every individual is part of a context. For example, people have people around them, so we are right now each other's interpersonal context, and obviously we perceive what other people do, and therefore these other people, you from my perspective, are also a way to influence people's behavior. There's also sometimes an organizational context. You are all colleagues, which means you have managers who have managers who have managers, even though the higher up they get, the less they like to think about the fact that they still have managers. And the fact that you have managers and that you have authority and that you have formal relationships and that you have like a cafeteria and that somebody decides what's served in the cafeteria, etc., create lots of different opportunities to actually change people's behavior. Opportunities that you don't have in somebody's home context, for example. In some communities, you actually have a big community. This is, for example, the case for groups of people that are minorities. They tend to be a bit closer. You have people in certain religions who form communities, which also give different unique points of leverage, so to speak, to change people's behavior. And finally, everybody's in a society, and the societies together form the world. So you have all these different environmental levels where people are located. And at all these levels, stuff can happen to change their behavior. And stuff does happen. So some people might have a lot of money, other people might have very little money, which obviously influences their behavior. Some people might be exposed to alcohol or to apples. There might be free condoms available in a gay sauna, or there might not be. So all these organizational things create opportunities for behavior or barriers to behavior. And then, of course, everybody does stuff in that environment. There are lots of different interventions created by different organizations, etc. So this individual that we need to change with their 90 billion neurons, with 7,000 connections to 90 billion neurons, that may already seem a bit complicated, but actually they're also in a complex system with lots of other people and organizations at different levels. Luckily, everything in their environment is ultimately under the control of people. Perhaps not the coronavirus, but most things in the environment are ultimately under the control of other people. And again, have brains. Well, not always, but some of them, quite a large proportion of them, has brains and makes sensible decisions, which means that you can actually use the same techniques that you use to individual your target population if you want to change something in their environment. So if you want to make sure that this cafeteria serves this lunch every day, then you just need to figure out who's in charge. You might need to figure out how whoever is in charge manages to prioritize this properly, frees up the right budget. You might need to talk to somebody one level higher or politicians to make sure they fund the Thomas More, so that there's actually enough money for this lunch, etc. But it all boils down to people, and they all have reasons for doing what they do, and they're all usually quite intelligent, and they think about these things, so they're usually sensible reasons. But it's doable. So once we understand how to change what's inside somebody's mind, you can change everything in the world. So we are back at the 90 billion neurons with the 7,000 connections. Luckily, when we want to change those, we rarely work at that level. You all now have many less neurons than you had about 10 or 20 years ago. Not because of the alcohol, well, maybe partly because of the alcohol, but mostly because losing neurons, or rather losing connections, is how you learn. What your brain does is basically randomly create connections, see how well they perform, comparable to the machine learning networks that Fernando presented earlier. See how well those networks perform, and the ones that perform well are retained and converted to the rest of the system, and the ones that don't perform well are deleted again. And as you get older, you learn better how to live, how to do stuff that works well. So you basically need less of those connections because you just retain the ones that work well for you. That's basically the learning, that's what we'll need to do. That's how we change what inside people's heads. And there are a number of learning processes that have evolved. And the first one to evolve was habituation. And habituation is simply the fact that you can learn to ignore stuff that's irrelevant. For example, as you see here, some people live very close to airports. Some people live very close to railroad tracks. And they survive. They're fine. They sometimes don't even hear the train anymore. Because your brain simply learns that apparently nothing happens when you hear it. So why waste any resources attending it? Classical conditioning is a very well-known example from Pavlov with his dog, who noticed that when he entered his lab, the sound of his footsteps triggered salivating in the dog. And normally the dog didn't use to salivate whenever it heard footsteps. And then Pavlov learned, aha, it realizes that when I enter the lab, the first thing I do is give the dog food. So he started to play around with this using lamps, etc. So classical conditioning is the ability to learn that two things are associated. It's not very impressive, I admit, but it can be very useful in interventions. Operant conditioning is simply the phenomenon that if you reward a behavior, it will increase in frequency, and if you punish a behavior, it will decrease in frequency. People with pets or children will be quite familiar with this. Procedural memory is our ability to combine small chunks of activities, small chunks of tasks, into programs that you can execute in one go. A classical example is, of course, riding a bike. Another classical example is tying your shoelaces. Apparently, I've actually never tried it myself, but it was on the internet, so it has to be true. Apparently, if you try to tie your shoelaces consciously, so you have to think about your actions before you do them, it's almost impossible. Whereas if you just do it automatically, it goes almost automatically. So that those are examples of procedural memory. Vicarious learning is a really powerful one, because this is the first one that allows us to learn not through our own experience, but by observing other organisms. And because it's so important, I made a little movie in PowerPoint, which is really pain in the ass, so that means that it's a really, really short movie, so you have to pay attention. So he's dead, which is very sad for Barney, but good for us, because it allows me to explain that now Fred realizes that he shouldn't go into the bush. He didn't have to go into the bush himself. That seems kind of trivial, but this was the first learning process that evolved that enabled organisms to actually not enter the bush themselves. It's the first time organisms could learn by observation. Of course, it's not easy to use this if you want to change people's behavior. Because obviously, organisms don't indiscriminately copy all behavior they see around them. There are some conditions. So the behavior needs to be positively reinforced. The behavior needs to be exhibited by an individual they identify with. Because, for example, if a bird, if a caveman sees a bird flying down a hillside to get some nice berries, then those cavemen that actually, or women, those cave people who also dove after the bird to get the same berries, were quickly selected out by evolution. So using these learning processes is tricky, but possible. Reflective learning is the first one that only humans can do. So reflective learning consists of thinking back to, for example, Saturday night, and thinking, what have I been doing? Should I have done it that way? Should I maybe do it differently next time? Only humans can do this using our autobiographical memory. So these learning processes evolved over time. Bees have cognitive maps. That's one of the other learning processes, to have a representation of the geography in your mind. Amoebas, like one-cell organisms, can even habituate already. So that's good for them. But we are the only ones who have autobiographical memory as far as we know. Also, as far as we know, this is the sum total of learning processes that have evolved. That means that inevitably, if you develop anything that is to achieve anything in humans, if you want to change something in their minds, you'll need to, in some way, leverage one or more of these. But they are also, at the same time, very fundamental. So that's why, oh yeah, you see now the font color is not ideal. If anybody does work with behavior change, we are creating a free open access book called bookofbehaviorchange.com. So if you actually find this interesting, you can read about it in the bookofbehaviorchange.com. What we usually do when we change behavior is that we use methods for behavior change that are actually defined at a higher level. So we don't actually use reflective learning or procedural memory, but we have other procedures, like for example, planning coping responses, that utilize those lower level evolutionary learning processes. So planning consists of identifying barriers to performing a target behavior, and then letting people think about how to deal with those barriers. For example, if you want to go running, a possible barrier might be that it might rain. So you think about, if I want to go running and it is raining, what do I do? And this works to help people go run more frequently. So what we do actually when we change behavior is that we use these methods of behavior change. And those have now finally been published in an open access article. And there are 99 of these. So that's a lot. So the question becomes, if you want to develop a campaign to make nightlife safe, 99 should you use? So then the question becomes, we know now how to change the behavior. The next question is, how do we pick one of these methods to change behavior? And this we have to do depending on what we want to change. If you talk to people, then the responses they give will usually be something like, if we get back to our example of highly dosed ecstasy, they'll think about whether they like the effects of a high dose, they think about what their friends think they should do, whether they can actually get pills with a low dose purpose by highly dosed MDMA and they just don't have the option. Whether if they use a high dose as compared to a lower dose, they can connect to others more easily. Whether they get more energy from a high dose than from a regular dose. What their friends do. Whether they're actually able to even dose to the degree they want or whether they just take whatever they get. Will their memory be impaired if they use a high dose? Is a higher dose more unhealthy or maybe more healthy? Because it's more pure. Does a high dose make you hallucinate more? And of course, do I like to hallucinate? Some people like hallucinogenic drugs, some people don't. So these are the kinds of answers you get from people when you ask, why do you do what they do? I mean, only these you only get if you ask why they use a high dose of ecstasy, not if you ask why they don't exercise, but you get the drift. So the key to connecting this qualitative mess of answers to the question why people do what they do to those 99 methods that we can use to change behavior lies in psychological theory. What psychological theory did, group all those reasons into clusters and then give those a name. This is an example of one theory, the theory of planned behavior, which has now been succeeded by the reasoned action approach and was preceded by the theory of reasoned action. Basically, this theory clumps together a cluster of reasons and they say, this is attitude. An attitude are all the reasons people have that pertain to what they think the consequences are if they perform a behavior and whether or not they like those consequences. And another cluster of reasons are about the perceived norms. So what I think you think I should do and what I think you do yourself, which is not always the same. And you have another one, which is called self-efficacy or perceived behavioral control, which is about whether I think I actually have the skills to do it. These theories have so-called constructs. And those constructs have definitions. And then the theories just say, this is how we think all those constructs relate. So this theory, the theory of planned behavior, argues that if behavior is planned, so obviously it doesn't apply to habitual behaviors because that's not what the theory was developed for. If a behavior is planned, then intention is a strong predictor of the behavior, and intention to perform the behavior is itself predicted by attitude, perceived norms, and self-efficacy or perceived behavioral control. Those are basically two names for the same construct. So these theories are very useful because they allow us to create some sense of order in this mess of answers people give us when we ask them why they do what they do. This is why these methods of behavior change in books like the intervention mapping book or in that article I just showed are always organized in tables for each of those constructs. So you have some methods you can use to target attitude. So if you ask people why they do what they do and the reasons you get are mostly because I think it will make me happy or because it helps me achieve my goals or whatever, then you know it's probably mostly attitude that's important. But it's also possible that mostly norm determines what people do or that it's actually attitude and norm are fine, but people just think they can't do it, so they won't. So if you know why people do what they do, then you know what kind of methods you can use to change. And there are loads of those determinants because there are loads of theories. So that's nice on the one hand, because there's always something that works for your target behavior and target population. It's also a bit overwhelming on the other hand. It's even more overwhelming because those constructs have nice brief names and definitions, but what you actually target in an intervention are the specific ideas people have. You don't target their attitude. You target whether they believe, if they use a high dose, that they will hallucinate or not. So just to recap, if you want to change people's health and or happiness, you have to work through the people, and we do this with interventions. Those interventions can only work if they use methods of behavior change that successfully leverage those evolutionary learning principles. And then they change determinants that have to be important for the target behavior. Or actually, they don't change the determinants. They change the specific subdeterminants, the specific ideas people have that are clustered in the determinant. And then hopefully, at the right time, the right neurons in somebody's nervous system will fire. And then their motor activity will start, so they perform the right behavior. You can think of it as a kind of causal structural chain. It starts on the left side with the behavior change principles. Those are the methods from the book. If you apply those in an intervention in a way that they work, for example, to take the example of vicarious learning with Fred Flintstone, as I indicated there, it's important that if you use vicarious learning, people watch somebody perform a behavior, and the person who has to perform the behavior, the model, has to be positively reinforced, and they have to be somebody that the audience can identify with, otherwise it won't work. So there are always some of those conditions, some of those parameters you have to satisfy. So that's also the case for, that's the case for every method. So if you apply those methods properly in some kind of application of the method, so an intervention, and those interventions manage to change the right subdeterminants, so the right specific ideas people have, which are part of a determinant, and then you change the right subbehaviors, then eventually people's behavior will change. Focuses on the middle bit, focuses on figuring out why people do what they do. What are the determinants and the subdeterminants of nightlife related? And we do this with questionnaires like this. This is how the first version looks. So we have a number of beliefs that we ask people about, and then people indicate to what degree they hold that belief. For example, if they use a high dose of ecstasy, they might believe that making contact with others might be actually harder, might be impaired, or it might be facilitated. And that, of course, influences whether those people will be likely to use a high dose. Or it might not influence. That's the point of party panel. So that for different target behaviors, we talked to lots of people, and we made a huge list of everything that we thought might very well be important. And then we find out what is important. And the interesting thing about this approach is that actually the things that are not associated are usually more interesting findings than the things that are important predictors. Because everything we started out with measuring were all sorts of beliefs that we thought these might very well be important, which means that proving ourselves wrong, figuring out which ones are apparently not important, is usually even more interesting to know. So the design of Party Panel was that we start with determining for every wave, because we did this every year for 5 years, we figure out the target behavior. What do we want to target this year? And we do this with the project board and with a group of experts regarding nightlife risks. Then we, once we know the rough behavioral domain, which can be something like ecstasy use or hearing protection or whatever, we figure out the exact target behaviors that we can measure, because we can't measure everything, of course, so you have to be pretty selective. Then we ask so-called unity pairs why they think people do what they do. Unity is an intervention in the Netherlands, a peer education intervention, where people who use drugs themselves suggest or advise other people how to minimize the risks when they use drugs. Then, once we have that list of beliefs, we create the questionnaire. This is filled out by people who attend nightlife, the Dutch nightlife. Then we analyze these, or I analyze these. And then we have a report. And the idea was here that we would just create a report. We created infographics for the participants, and we created a report for the intervention developers. And in that report, we basically show them the results of the analysis so that they would know exactly what was important and what was not important for this target behavior. So if they want to develop an intervention, they just know what to target in the intervention. Unfortunately, that didn't go exactly as planned. For recruitment, we relied mostly on organizations, and that also didn't always go exactly as planned. This is a very nice example where, from a social media post, where one of the party organizers actually created something in their house style, their corporate style, whatever, to help recruit participants. But not all companies did that, because apparently, as it turns out, unlike us at a university, these huge organizations that organize parties have something called a social media agenda, which is actually chock full with posts that are timed, and you can't just insert stuff because you want to. So that turned out to be a bit more challenging. In total, we did 5 rounds about these 5 target behaviors. And in these 5 rounds, we managed to pretty much get to the target population, if you look at age at least. Most people are around their 20s, 30s, which are most people who represent. Interestingly, when you look at the gender, you see that the gender varies with topic. So the first wave, the one we did in 2015, was about MDMA use. And you see that 61% of the participants was male. So apparently men are more interested in that topic than women. In 2018, the topic was flirting and transgressions of personal boundaries, where we saw exactly the other pattern. So apparently more women were interested in that topic. This is important to realize because it means that what you find in these online surveys can't be generalized easily to the population, because obviously people know what the survey is about when they decide whether they want to join. So, about testing. To give an idea about the kind of results we got, this is one of the rating scales that participants used, except then without the colors. And then for this question, we found these results. So, as you see, most people here indicated that they would feel more socially isolated if they use a high dose of ecstasy. And only very few people indicated they would feel less socially isolated. We also asked what people prefer. And the overwhelming majority prefers to feel less socially isolated. So ecstasy is kind of known as a social drug, so it kind of makes sense that people, if they use ecstasy, they like to connect to others. They don't want to socially isolate themselves. These two are opposite. So this is already a useful kind of coat hanger for an intervention. People indicate that if they use a high dose of ecstasy, they're actually more likely to get socially isolated. And they also indicate that they prefer to not be socially isolated. So that means that in an intervention, you can actually confront people with this paradox, which might help you to persuade them. Another example is that people indicate that if they use a high dose, they remember much less, which makes sense because this is also true. So you actually do remember less, so most people notice it. And they prefer to remember much more, obviously. So this is the same kind of contradiction. On the one hand, people know that actually their trip, their experience will be worse. But on the other hand, they apparently clearly still do this. So that means that this is a way to communicate to them about reasons they have for not using high doses. Most results actually looked kind of like this. This is a confidence interval based estimation of relevance plot, which combines two sources of information you need if you want to decide what to focus on in an intervention. These are the same results that we just showed. Basically, if you use a high dose, making contact is much harder or much easier. And you see the individual participants' scores in this plot with the confidence interval, the 99.99% confidence interval in the middle. So you see here everybody scores roughly. You see that people, that if you look at how much people think they remembered, most people scored on the bottom side of the scale. So most people indicated they remember much less. So like this, you can see what people already believe in your target population, which obviously is useful to know before you develop an intervention targeting them. Lots of people, if they start to develop an intervention, they think that they already know what the target population thinks. Unfortunately, that's usually not the case. We also did some studies where we let people predict these kinds of patterns. And unfortunately, even experts, like Suzanne explained, can't actually predict these. And these confidence interval-based estimation of relevance plots, or cyber plots, contain a second panel. And the second panel shows the association to behavior in this case. There are actually two variables here, the yellow one and the purple one. So the combination of the information in these two panels allows you to judge simultaneously what people believe and how strongly the degree to which they believe that thing is associated to what they do. And those are both things you need to target, you need to think about when you decide on intervention targets. So for example, in this case, there's an association to behavior and there is still some room for improvement. In this case, there is an association to behavior, because this is the so-called correlation coefficient. Basically, the further to the right, the more positive the association. But in the case of health, everybody already believes that higher dose is worse for your health. So because everybody already believes that a higher dose is worse for your health, that's not a viable intervention target. You can achieve almost no improvement there, even though there's an association to behavior. So you always have to compare those two. Very often this is done with regression analysis, but there are some reasons why you actually want to look at the so-called bivariate associations rather than putting all predictors in one model. So when you create these graphs, you basically know exactly what to target in an intervention. Of course, you could just tell people I would target on this, but it very much depends on your target population and where you are, and you might want to communicate certain messages, but you might prefer not to communicate other messages. But our idea was if we provide people with these and we explain how to interpret them, then the prevention workers can start using them. Unfortunately, it turned out that that didn't work quite like that. I'll show you how we solve that later on. First, I'll show you a bit about how highly people actually dose, because we started studying using high-dose MDMA because there were worries about highly dosed MDMA pills in the Netherlands. That's probably the same here. The average dose used to be around 80 to 90 milligrams of MDMA in a pill, and now it's double that. And the normal dose, the optimal dose for most people, is about 80 or 90 milligrams. So that means that if people now use a pill, they actually have a worse trip than like 20 years ago. So we asked people what they actually prefer and how strong their pills are. So most people here indicate, or you see quite a spread here, and this blue line corresponds to exactly the same dose. So if everybody would have exactly the pills at their preferred dose, everybody would score on the blue line. You see that quite a lot of people are below the blue line, which means that they have stronger pills than they would prefer. So partly here, people would actually appreciate ecstasy pills to be a bit weaker. I'm not sure whether there are any ecstasy producers here, but if there are. We also asked about the association between weight and dose, because your ideal weight, like with any drug, or most drugs probably not any drug, but usually the optimal dose depends on your weight. And this green area indicates the recommendations. And you can already see probably by the height of the plot. Oh, that was the battery probably. Yeah, I can scream or switch to the other one. Let's see how easily is the red button on. Ah, yeah. Ah, excellent. Okay, so as you might already see by the height of the plot, lots of people scored higher, unfortunately. So you see that most people score way higher than the recommended dose. And if you would do a regression analysis here, that's the blue line. So that's actually the association between how much people weigh and how highly they dose, which is roughly double the, they use roughly double the milligrams of MDMA as their weight in kilograms. We also asked people whether they thought they were tolerant for ecstasy. Tolerance is a phenomenon you develop. If you use a drug a lot, then you need more to get the same effect. And you see that here, the red dots are the people who indicated they had developed tolerance, and the blue dots are the people who indicated they didn't. And as you can already see here, there's no association. It's not the case that the people who self-reported tolerance also dose higher. Okay, we also asked people in the round next year why they do or don't visit nightlife first aid. And for that, I have again a short movie to summarize.
Among 1,122 participants about visiting the first aid if you feel unwell while going out. We asked them about different beliefs related to two specific behaviors. Visiting the first aid yourself if you feel unwell, and taking a friend to the first aid if they feel unwell. It shows that the intention to visit the first aid yourself is related to the estimated severity of the concern. As long as someone trusts it will go away, he or she is less likely to visit the first aid. Taking a friend to the first aid, this is determined by whether one thinks friends would approve and whether these friends would do so themselves. An intervention could address the accessibility of the first aid, emphasizing that guests are also welcome with less serious or mild symptoms. Show that evaluating the severity by yourself is very difficult, especially if you're intoxicated, and confirm the social norm that it's normal to take someone who's unwell.
For hearing protection, we use these confidence interval-based estimation of relevance plots. We also use those to create the movies, but show them. So as you'll remember, you can see here where people score. So most people indicate they find it very pleasant if their earplugs fit well. Well, that's not very surprising. Of course, most things where you see an effect will not be surprising, because everything we measured because a priori we thought that they would be relevant. What's actually more shocking is the things where you don't see an association. For example, most people didn't really find it very unpleasant to hear the music less loud, while most organizers of parties think that everybody wants the music to be as loud as possible. So you get these graphs, you see the score, and you get the associations to behavior. And then you see here at the top, for example, you see two beliefs, two representations people have of the world that are positively associated. So the more people have this representation, the more likely they are to wear earplugs. And at the bottom, they're negatively associated. So if people would really hate losing their earplugs, they're less likely to use earplugs. And again, it's important to keep in mind that the ones that are strongly associated are good to know, but less shocking, obviously, because we measure them because we thought they would be strongly associated. These are beliefs people have about their own capabilities. And there are two in particular that are important: whether people think they can remember to put their earplugs in time, and the fact that they indicate that if they use drugs or alcohol, that they are less likely to put their earplugs in. Those two are important because we use them in an intervention I'll show in a bit. Flirting and transgression. Flirting and transgression is actually one of the reasons why we started making these movies. We created these cyberplots, and we have loads of them, so we have a lot of evidence for people to base interventions on. However, in the intervention in 2018, we were involved in developing an intervention about exactly this topic. And it was all very nicely coordinated, so we measured why people deal with threshold boundary transgressions the way they do, so that this information could be used in the intervention. However, it turned out that for a lot of people who develop these interventions, even those visualizations we used are too hard to process. They're just too far away from how they were trained. So they actually didn't know how to deal with them. That's why we basically took those 20-something visualizations and created 1-minute little movies of them, so that actually the information would reach them in a way. And we have this general explanation of why we actually do a party panel.
How do you develop effective interventions to change risk behavior among partygoers? First, you have to know why they behave. Unfortunately, simply asking, hey, why do you do this, is not enough. Our behavior is affected by a combination of environmental factors and personal beliefs about this behavior. Mostly, we're not aware of these. In order to find out which beliefs determine risk behavior of partygoers, we set up Party Panel. We work according to different theories on behavioral change. One of these is the reasoned action approach. It holds that these beliefs can be divided into three categories. Attitude. This is about the expected consequences of this behavior and how you evaluate those. Perceived norms. This is about whether you think others approve and what you think others do themselves. And perceived behavioral control. This is about whether you think you can successfully perform this behavior. All beliefs we study come from experts and a group of partygoers and are measured in questionnaires that are filled out by participants online. The answers to the questionnaires provide an insight into which beliefs the participants hold and which beliefs most strongly affect their behavior. As an example, let's take the behavior brushing your teeth. Let's say you want to make people who don't brush their teeth enough brush more often by means of an intervention. First, you need to understand why they don't brush their teeth often enough. You want to know which beliefs people have about the consequences of not brushing their teeth often enough and how important they are. For example, the premise: if I don't brush my teeth often enough, it's more likely that I'll get cavities, and I definitely don't like cavities. Or, if I do brush my teeth often enough, this will surely freshen my breath, and I like that. But you also want to know what people assume about opinions and behaviour of others, and how important this is to them. For example, my girlfriend likes it if I brush my teeth And you also want to know how easy or just how difficult it is to brush your teeth often enough. I don't brush my teeth more often because I often forget. This shows no perceived behavioral control. I always have enough toothpaste and an extra toothbrush at home. Shows a lot of perceived behavioral control. So, it's possible that people expect that brushing their teeth often enough reduces the risk of cavities, but that it doesn't affect their behaviour. At the same time, it is possible that a partner's opinion does strongly predict whether they brush often enough. So, an ad featuring a happy girlfriend will have a stronger impact than one featuring a dentist giving advice. Once you know which beliefs most strongly predict the behaviour you wish to change, you can start figuring out which methods are most likely to be effective. For more info about the behaviours we have studied using...
This is one of the movies we created accompanying the other ones to basically get the information to prevention workers that they needed to actually get why you need to know why people do what they do. This is the intervention that was ultimately created. One of the main outcomes of this party panel round was that one of the reasons why people don't intervene when they see boundary transgressions in nightlife, so basically when a MeToo, hashtag MeToo is occurring, one of the reasons why they don't intervene is because they don't know how to intervene and they don't know how to deal with the situation. If somebody gets angry, they don't know what to do. This, of course, is not easy to put in an intervention. And unfortunately, that was not actually put in the intervention by the company, the advertising agency, that created this. In the beginning, when we explained how we worked and that we have models and theories, they were very enthusiastic. But once they actually started working, it turned out to be completely incompatible with how they normally work. Plus, they didn't actually have this expertise about behavior change. Normally, the supervisor or the organization giving them their assignment can monitor this. But if the prevention organizations also don't have this expertise, then they're very easily follow whatever the advertising agency tells them. So that means here the focus was on a simple message. And the idea was that because it's a simple message, you can just ask, are you okay? If you see something that might be a boundary transgression. But as the advertising agency said, you can also think yourself when somebody is interacting with you. Am I okay? Do I think this is fine? Or if you are flirting with somebody, you can think, is this still okay? So that's kind of their solution. And that kind of works as a narrative. You can kind of see it happening. You can kind of think, oh, if somebody is flirting with somebody and they would think this all the time, then obviously they wouldn't transgress those boundaries. The problem is, unfortunately, that the fact that it works as a story doesn't mean that showing people this text changes their behavior. It doesn't implement those learning. Eventually, they actually started making little movies where they let people explain how they deal with those situations. One of the questions that I thought would be fun to show here is we asked people when they think their boundaries are being transgressed for different kinds of people. For somebody who you dislike, somebody who you are attracted to, but you haven't been flirting with yourself, and somebody you have been flirting with yourself. And here at the left-hand side, you see and these were the outcomes for somebody who you don't like. So you see, for example, that some people consider a sexual compliment to not be a transgression of their boundaries. A lot of people do consider a sexual compliment a transgression of their boundaries. But some people are apparently completely fine with it. Just like some people are fine with getting asked the question whether they want to kiss the other person. But a lot of people also consider this a transgression of their boundaries. This, of course, is a problem in a world where the discourse around boundary transgressions and hashtag MeToo's focuses largely on consent. Because asking for consent is actually perceived as transgressing somebody's boundaries. You're already violating people's boundaries by asking for consent. I thought this was quite shocking also because I have no idea what else you can do except for endorsing a consent system. If you're attracted to somebody, things start shifting. So already less people mind it if others ask them whether they want to kiss. Also, sexuality related compliments are sexually charged compliments are fine in many more situations. And now there is also a proportion of people who is fine with just being kissed. So if you find somebody attractive, for those people, they can just kiss them. And that's fine. So that means that actually at some point, if you look at the people that you are attracted to and that you're flirting with, there's only a small proportion here, but still a proportion that considers asking whether you want to kiss, a boundary transgression. And there's a roughly equally sized proportion who doesn't think that kissing them is a boundary transgression. Obviously, if you are not good at like spotting when you are flirting, and given that you don't always know whether somebody likes you, that means that for some people they'll be in a situation where they are equally likely to transgress somebody's boundaries when they just kiss them or when they ask them whether they want to kiss. Which I thought was interesting and makes it even more complicated. And the final one was about sleeping patterns, where we also asked whether people fall asleep more easily or whether it's harder if they use different types of drugs. And it indicates that with GHB, cannabis and alcohol, actually falling asleep is easier and falling asleep is harder. They're awake when they use ecstasy, MDMA, for example, speed or 4FA. We also asked people whether the quality of their sleep is better or worse. And then people indicate that with alcohol, they fall asleep more easily, but the quality of the sleep is worse. And with, for example, cocaine, some people said they fall asleep equally easily or a bit easier, but most people said that the quality of the sleep was worse. So this means that you can actually use this to inform people if they go to a festival of multiple days, what kinds of drugs they should definitely avoid before they go to sleep. You could even in theory tell them what drugs they should use, but that's like ethically a bit more complicated message. These are the five ways we had so far, and we developed all these movies to try to get prevention workers to use the results. And we developed infographics for the participants in the the nightlife patterns. And this was used in a number of interventions. So the question is, does it actually work or not? And this was luckily evaluated last year by a colleague of mine because we wanted it to be independent. I'll write some of his slides. And he focused on three behaviors: bringing earplugs, wearing them once you brought them, and if you don't have them, buying them at the event. And he used these cyber plots to figure out what to actually target to change each of these behaviors. And based on this, they developed three interventions. The first, and they were all really, really simple because we didn't have much budget, and that was the idea. We just wanted to test the concept. So the first one, we would ask organizations to email guests at a party to bring earplugs. The Unity peers from the peer education intervention would remind people at the beginning of the festival to wear earplugs. And finally, the place where you could buy earplugs would be clearly placed on the map. So that was it. And then the research question were, does it work? So do participants wear earplugs more frequently? And do the organizers do what we asked them to do? Because we didn't only evaluate this intervention, but the entire Celebrate Safe approach. And it was pre-registered, which means that the analysis plan and the research questions were publicly frozen somewhere online, so that we could be sure there was no staple-like activity. There were some festivals that dropped out because there were not enough peer education peers to actually go there to remind people to wear earplugs, which is actually a good sign that that's a large portion of the dropout, because that means that at least the organizers all collaborated. And it also means that the there was no selection bias in the participating. And some organizers shared the messages, so that was actually a good thing. And it was the places where you could buy earplugs were clearly indicated on the map. And sometimes there was a very nice big stand where you could find the Unity peer earplugs. Sometimes it was a tiny stand somewhere in the back of the festival. So there were varying degrees of success in implementation here. If you look at how many people wore earplugs, because this was actually a study where they used observation. They didn't ask people anything. They just observed how many people had earplugs, and there are like protocols, etc. You see that there was one festival where almost everybody wore earplugs. So on average, there was about 15-20% of the people at the festival wore earplugs, but one festival, almost everybody wore earplugs. If you keep this festival in the analysis, then these are the effectivenesses. So basically, these are the proportions of participants that wear earplugs. On the x-axis, you have the percentage, And here you have the two groups, the control group, the festivals where none of the interventions were implemented, and the experimental groups, the festivals where they were implemented. So you see that a much higher percentage, double roughly, uses earplugs. But that's also because this had the one party where almost everybody wore earplugs. So if you take that out, then the effect becomes much smaller, but is still considerable. So this actually worked, even though it's kind of cheap, so we were very happy about this. Unfortunately, the kind of subsidy scheme we got the grant in doesn't allow a second extension. So for this year, there's actually no money. But we'll think about how to take it forward from here. The Dutch government ideally saw this as a public-private collaboration, which in the mind of the government means that the private sector pays for it. The private sector doesn't quite necessarily agree. So the funding is still a bit tricky. But basically, this is the idea of how we set up this multidisciplinary system for studying why people do what they do, and then using this to develop interventions in Dutch nightlife to make sure that these various risk behaviors decrease a bit. If you have any questions, and all the data and stuff from PartyPanel are online, so if anybody wants to do analyses, it's there for the taking. Thank you.